This is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk radio like you've never heard it before.
Everybody, how are you? Welcome. It's Friday night here at the Ramble. We go until midnight, as you know, and we will be doing our citizens panel in just a little bit. But right now, over on the second camera, we've got girlfriend, the other half.
The other half is here. And yeah. I did 5 days this week.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Gee, my head is smaller than your head. I'm going to have to work this one out.
Let me move back.
Yeah, move back a little bit. Move back a little bit. There. Well, yeah, they can still hear you.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
What?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear
you. Can you hear me?
We can hear you now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anyway, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine.
Yeah.
My friend Janice, sorority sister of mine, is coming up for the week for business, and she's going to stay with us.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm excited about that. And Monday, Phyllis, Janice, and I will do something, have a nice lunch, and just talk.
And just talk.
For 5 hours.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I sometimes wonder, I'm not happy when people come to stay.
I understand that, but it's somebody that I wanted to see, and she's not staying that long. She's staying 2 nights, and she's going up to Connecticut for 2 days, and then back for 1 night, and then she leaves.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so it's a little break.
Yeah, but I still can't use my room.
I understand, but, you know, it's not as long as certain people that have come by. I don't want to mention any names.
Yeah.
But, I mean, oh, my.
Yeah, yeah. So, anyway, I don't know. I have nothing to talk about. What?
I was just...
I have nothing to talk about.
That's unusual.
Yeah, let me see here. Oh, yeah, I have something to talk about.
That's either about his ailments or his diet.
No.
Or...
Nope.
The ailments. It's definitely going to be ailments.
It's not an ailment at all.
It is.
No. See, you have so little faith in me.
That's true.
That you think that's the, you know.
Well, I hear most of it.
You hear most. I out with you.
Yeah.
But my leg is...
Ailments, ailments.
But that's
ailments.
Not what I wanted to talk about, so that doesn't count.
Diet.
No. We tonight maybe had...
the worst.
The worst meal we've ever had in this neighborhood.
It was pretty
good.
Okay,
now let me give them a little history. We used to go to this place.
Yeah, it was. It started by the guy that did Red Rooster up on 125th
Which
Street.
Which is a world-class restaurant.
Yeah, and he started this, and it was a very down-home chicken sandwiches with corn on the cob.
And
ribs. They had ribs.
Did they have ribs?
Yeah, I think so.
I don't think so.
Anyway, Alex starts his diet, so all restaurants are off. So we go back a year.
So we haven't been there in maybe...
Over a year.
Maybe longer than that.
I think about a year and a half. So we went tonight. Now you take on.
So she wants to go out to eat, and she wants to go all the way over about half hours away by cab. Okay.
Or we could walk.
Well, I can't walk.
So we could have taken We could have taken the M2,
which
is an express bus right across the street.
Yeah. Well, that would that.
Gotten just, off at 96th Street and only had to walk two blocks.
But you didn't suggest that.
I did too.
But anyway. So she wants to go out and eat. So
no,
I said,
I don't want to leave the neighborhood.
Well, I didn't feel like leaving the neighborhood.
Well, he left the house. I have to tell you, he was still wearing his pajamas when I came home from work.
So?
I'm just saying.
I'm wearing them now. Look. Oh, wait a minute. I have to get back here so you can see these things. See that? Anyway. But from the top, from the waist
right,
up,
so
I look
we,
very neat.
Now we walk into the restaurant.
Anyway, so we go into the restaurant. It's this Harlem Tavern.
And there's a line around the corner.
Yeah, there's a line around
and
the corner.
And it's like 5:45. Yeah. It's early.
So now she says, well, let's walk down the street and see what else there is. Okay. And then I'm thinking, nah, I don't like that. Why don't we go to that chicken place?
That we used to love. And we did.
And she said, well, you can't because your diet. And I said, well, my diet is now, I don't have to be strict about it.
Call me Whoopi. Whoopi?
Whoopi?
Goldberg.
No, I'm not going to gain the weight back like she did. I wake up, you know, I have... Those dreams?
I told you, folks.
I've had those nightmares.
Here it
that
comes.
All of a sudden, I gain all this weight back. Yes. But anyway.
That's a combination of health
and
weight.
Can I tell them the story? Yes. Then she says, oh, look, there's no line anymore at the Harlem Tavern. So we ask them for a table, and they take us right in. How do you describe the noise that
was
in
there? Well, first of all, it's a restaurant. A half, 50% of the restaurant is outside with a canvas roof. Yeah. So there's no insulation, so the noise is just everywhere.
Well, it's not that there's insulation. If they didn't have the roof and they were seating people out there, it would be quiet.
Well, that's
because
it.
The sound would have somewhere to go.
And the inside, it's a sports bar, so there's a television every 12 inches, and it's loud.
I mean, so we sat down to eat, and I said...
It was so loud, we couldn't totally hear each other.
When I was 25, I couldn't stand to eat here under these conditions.
Yeah, so we left.
So we got up and left. And she says, well, let's go to the chicken place. So we walk across the street to the chicken place. To your credit, you did say, let's walk down the street and see if there's something else. But I said, you know, my thing about going and looking for restaurants is you're going to wind up spending a lot of money eating at bad restaurants.
But that's how you find out. That's how that's how we found our little Italian restaurant that we love so much.
Yeah, but that was a fluke.
No, I think there's other flukes in Harlem now.
I think, you know, for all that we'd like to think that New York is a great place for food, it has really got some of the worst food in the world.
Well, up in Harlem, what happened was with the gentrification came all these expensive little restaurants that are expensive and low quality food. I mean, the food is not worth the price.
Yeah.
And it's very pricey, and a lot of these are not going to hang around. They'll get taken over. Yeah. But right now, it's still in the transition.
But, you know,
stage.
I know that at the Harlem Tavern, I can have, what is that stuff that I like?
Ceviche.
Ceviche, you know. So I can have that. And, you know, so there's...
So to make a long story short,
yeah,
we go into this chicken place that mm-hmm. was once owned, as we said, by the guy that owns, what's it called?
It's called the Red Rooster.
Red Rooster, right. So he has this little chicken place.
And it was a great little chicken place. In fact, that was a go-to place for me when I wanted to take people
cheap.
To go to a
cheap but good.
Go to a restaurant, you know,
in Harlem.
And say, hey, I got a good little restaurant. Let's go to this one. And they would always rave about it. They say, hey, that was great. It was a great chicken sandwich. You know, I love.
They only had a slim menu, but one of them was corn on the cob and spicy. I mean, it's like rolled and spicy.
Well, it was.
I have the recipe.
No, actually, it's paprika. I think.
No, I have the recipe.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway,
I made them. Don't you remember?
So we go in to the place.
Yeah.
And we sit down. It's the same place it's always been that we remember, right?
Except no corn on the menu.
Well, no, then we look at the menu. And she's going, are there a lot of things missing on this menu?
Yeah.
I said, yeah, like food. You know?
Yeah, there was nothing.
No, there wasn't the
no appetizer.
No appetizers, no corn on the cob. No. They still had their, what do you call it, mac and cheese.
Yeah.
You know. But it really just, the menu was far more limited. So I decided for my diet and stuff, I would order the Hull's chicken. I want, you know, it's a chicken place. I'll get the chicken, right?
And I ordered a shrimp taco.
Yeah. Describe your shrimp taco.
Well, first it was deep fried.
Well, first it came in, it was cold.
Well, I said, is this meal supposed to be hot or cold? She said, what do you mean? I said, well, is it supposed to be hot or cold? Because it was stone cold. So they took it back. They apologized. I'm sure it was the exact same shrimp. They were deep fried shrimp that I don't think were shrimp.
You gave me a taste of it, and I couldn't identify.
It didn't taste like shrimp. It tasted fishy.
I couldn't identify the taste.
Yeah. And there were three of these tacos. So I nibbled on one and didn't finish the other two.
Yeah. And so I had the chicken.
Right.
And...
You ate the whole chicken.
I did, but I forced myself to because I knew that it was costing me $22. And, yeah, you know. So I decided I better eat the chicken.
Eat the $22 worth.
It was so dry.
So dry.
That I had to drink a lot of soda while eating it to get it to wash down. Right?
I did suggest that we get it to go.
Now, if you think this is all bad, this is a whole bad story I'm telling you, will you stop potchkeying with stuff down there? Anyway, you would think that that was bad enough, that the food sucked. That a place that we had gone to with fond memories of the food being fun.
Right.
You know, fun and enjoyable, was now a place of absolute terrible food.
Horrible.
Anyway. The worst part about it was...
Wait.
It took them forever.
Right.
To serve us. And that's why hers was cold. Mine was warm, but they made my chicken, they made her stuff, and it was sitting there.
Yeah.
Obviously not under some kind of light to keep it hot. And when they sent yours back, I swear to you, they probably just threw it back in the fryer and warmed it up.
Oh, well, I'm sure the shrimp were exactly the same, and they probably just put it under the heat
lamp. But it didn't taste like shrimp. It tasted like...
Like fish sticks.
Yeah. Like they went up to Costco and bought fish sticks. Yeah. And yeah.
Mrs. Whatever.
Yeah. It was just
horrible.
It was just ghastly, you know? Yeah. So here we had this terrible dinner.
And then Alex says, I need to feel better about myself because it was such a horrible dinner. There is a 7-Eleven, and I'm going to go in and get a Slurpee. I said, Alex, that's not on your diet. He said, oh, no, they have diet-free Slurpees now.
Yeah. They did.
Okay.
They did, not diet-free. But if they were diet-free, they would
sugar-free.
They would have sugar in them.
Sugar-free.
Sugar-free. So I went and had sugar-free grape.
I waited outside.
I thought, it's great. I love grape, and I love the sugar-free.
This is our night. This is our life.
I pour the Slurpee. Have you been into the Slurpee culture at all?
Never.
In your time?
Never. I've never even had one.
Slurpees are wonderful, actually. They're really quite good. And let me explain why.
The blue one or the green one?
No, they have this...
They have a blue. I saw somebody sipping a blue Slurpee.
Like, they're like ice with flavoring in it.
Yeah.
You know.
We call it water ice in Philadelphia.
I don't know. I'm pouring this thing out, and it says, do not use this machine if the light is lit. That means it's freezing the stuff more, right?
Mine
didn't have the light lit, so I poured it, right? And it there's something weird about it, but I figured, yeah, it's a Slurpee. It's 7-Eleven. It's got to be a Slurpee, right? I buy the thing. I leave. I take a sip of it. It has no semblance of being a Slurpee, all right? No semblance of Slurpee. Just absolutely. Oh, I want to see if we're on, by the way.
That would help.
That would help. Yeah, let me see here. I forgot to put up the... Yeah, there it is.
There we are?
There we are, yeah. The Slurpee was not a Slurpee. It was a...
Sludge.
A melted Slurpee, right?
Sounds disgusting.
And
they're usually blue. They're like a bright winter blue that you never see in anything that's natural.
Colors that are not in nature.
Right. Blue.
No, but this thing was grape colored, and it would have been really good.
Purple.
If it was a Slurpee, but it wasn't a Slurpee. So I got to try the 7-Eleven that's two blocks away now. We never had 7-Elevens in this neighborhood because they didn't like Negroes.
Well, the neighborhood's changing.
Yeah, yeah. So it's safe for 7-Eleven. You know, 7-Eleven, you know, you've been into 7-Elevens, right? Who hasn't, you know?
Remember we ate an equivalent to one in Beijing?
Yes, we did.
It was the 7-Eleven that's over there.
Yeah, but they didn't
And we got our dinner there.
But you know what they didn't have?
What?
Didn't have Slurpees.
Well, that's true.
And why didn't they have Slurpees?
Because they don't drink cold over
They don't
there.
Drink ice.
Right.
The Chinese do Bing, not like to eat
the
ice.
The only word I learned in Chinese is Bing, and that means ice.
Yeah, so that you
You learn. You learn what you need.
Usually what they give you before you eat dinner is a slightly warm glass of water.
Water sometimes with lemon in it.
Yeah. And the Chinese do not use cold in their...
Right.
But anyway, So you can't get a Slurpee there. So it was a 7-Eleven.
It was equivalent to a 7. That's their 7-Eleven.
Unlike any other 7-Eleven.
We had been touring all day and we're absolutely exhausted.
No, this was right across the street.
No, I'm talking about in Beijing. Yeah,
Beijing. It was right across the street.
But the reason why we went to get our dinner there is because we were so tired we didn't want to go to a restaurant.
Yeah.
And we bought the stuff back. And it's Chinese crap, just the way it's American. Yeah, well,
it was a different 7-Eleven than you folks out there are used to.
Right, but it's Chinese crap.
Yeah.
You know, cookies, crackers, sodas.
Well, that's 7-Eleven.
That's 7-Eleven.
Anyway, the thing about 7-Eleven is, if you've ever noticed, at the door of the 7-Eleven is a ruler that goes up to the top of the door with the measurements of feet.
For kids?
No. Because they get robbed so often that they want to be able to identify the person who robbed them by the height. Yeah, that's why. You've ever wondered? And also, 7-Elevens, because they're open 24 hours a day, do not have locks on the door.
Right. Well, that happened in New York when they had the...
Yeah, but anyway, so, you know, they want to make sure people don't rob them, don't get away without having a good description of how tall they are.
And at least we know the officer that he was 5'2".
He was 5'2", very short.
Very short.
And then they go looking for a 5'2 guy.
So that was our dinner tonight, including the dessert that Alex got.
Well, that wasn't dessert. It wasn't meant to be dessert. I just said, I'm up here near the 7-Eleven. Let me get one of my favorite drinks of all time.
Oh, it's a drink.
Oh, you know what I used to love to do? In San Francisco, I would get in the car, go over to Marin County. Sometimes I'd be with somebody. Sometimes I would do this alone. And I would go to Fairfax. And right outside Fairfax is the road going out into the hinterlands of Marin, the country. And I would stop at the 7-Eleven. I would get myself
a Slurpee
and a big bag of beef jerky. And then that was my what I called my road food. And then I would
drive.
And sometimes I was, you know, I was with somebody, and sometimes I was by myself. Sometimes I would just take that ride because it was a nice ride to take and to think and be with yourself.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, of course.
But anyway, I would always stop at the 7-Eleven and get that. And so Slurpees and beef jerky have a certain soothing feeling for me. But it's gone forever now because of the 7-Eleven in Harlem. And I tried them once before.
Yeah.
And it was slushy.
Slushy.
It was not a Slurpee. It was a slushy. It was a watery goo.
So there you go. There's your answer. Yeah. They haven't been taught. They don't have quality control.
Notice I'm holding the cup this week.
Oh, yes. That's right. We had
the big spill. Last week we had the big spill. And somebody wrote that they watched it over and over again 10 times, saying it was the most funniest thing they've ever seen.
All I can say is I'm sure glad I didn't do it, because I would have gotten hell for that.
Well, of course you would.
I am sure glad that wasn't me.
Yeah, but I mean...
That spilled the coffee all over the...
Well, I've got electronic equipment here.
Right, but I'm sure glad it wasn't me.
I'm figuring this is going to cost me. You know, but we did...
We got it.
We did sop it up, and because I don't use sugar in
my
coffee...
Thank you, Marjorie.
Thank you, Marjorie. Because I don't use sugar in my coffee, then I'm cool. You know, I'm fine. So, anyway.
Hey, I think it's time.
It's not time. You always say that. You got 7 more minutes.
7 more minutes. Oh, God.
I'm too tired to do the show tonight. You want to do it?
Let me go to bed. I'm getting up early.
Because you monopolize the television set.
I get home. Today I got home, 4:30?
You know, she does this I got home card on me to make me feel guilty that I don't work.
I have 3 hours.
And she does.
I have 3 hours to just chill out and get ready for bed.
And so she watches stuff that I absolutely have no interest
in. Well, you watch your stuff that I have no interest in.
But I do it late at night or in the morning or whatever.
Yeah, when I'm away. So that's the only time I'm not away.
Like, you don't even know what's going on Riverdale.
And I could care less.
You don't even know what Riverdale is.
That's right.
It's the Archie and Veronica and Betty and Jughead.
Good.
But it's very good.
Good.
I enjoy it. It's one of my guilty pleasures. Well, and The Flash was very good this week. But Arrow was terrible.
We have our own programs, and there's nothing wrong with that.
Arrow has been
terrible. I like when you leave me alone in the bedroom. It's like my time.
You used to complain about that.
I like it now.
So you want me to leave you alone in the bedroom?
Well, it's nice to have a couple hours to myself.
Yeah, but then I have to go into the other room, and now that we're going to have a guest, I can't go into the other room.
Well, we did set the living room up as the third point.
Well, I don't like that.
It's only for
because
two nights.
The TV is up high, and I have two to look nights. At it like this. I don't know why people put TV sets over fireplaces.
Oh, you excuse know, me. I think it's time.
In fact, the set in the living room is 3D. But you can't watch 3D on it because it's so hot.
It's out of proportion.
It's out of proportion. It's up at an angle that the 3D doesn't really work.
Yeah. Well, you can do everything in the living room but 3D.
So I can watch 3D standing up and it's okay.
Or just watch other stuff.
You know. But, you know. So anyway. So they're stopping making 3D TV sets.
You're kidding.
Samsung stopped making them.
How about LG?
I think LG still does. Yeah.
It's got to be one of them.
Yeah, but I really,
I
really
think it's
love
great.
I love my 3D.
I mean, we get really good quality.
Oh, yes.
We don't watch it all the time, but when there's a 3D movie.
Especially when you have like a 4K set.
We have, by the way, at the Comfy Seat Theater, when they do the
Comfy
Chair Theater, when they have the 3D, we take our glasses. They ask them to send them back. Yeah. I have two bags of glasses that we have taken, which are ours.
What they do with them?
We didn't steal them.
They charge you $5 more to go to the 3D
movie.
That's
right. So we own, they're ours.
And you buy the, you have the glasses. You know what they do with those glasses? They don't throw them out.
They reuse them.
They hose them off and give it back to you.
They probably put it in one of those sanitizer machines. And
yeah. Well, one of these days, somebody is going to give somebody else conjunctivitis. And they're not going to be terribly happy with that.
I don't think so.
But the 3D TV at home, you know, with the new 4K, it's really terrific. It's really good. And I've always been a big 3D freak
from when I was
a kid. So I love having 3D in my home.
Yeah.
Man, that's like living life large.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway.
Time.
Well, and it's not time yet.
It's time.
It's not time yet. You think it's time. It's not time yet. Hold on a second. Having a little problem here getting things right. You want me to turn on the phone?
Sure. By the time you do, it's like 3 minutes.
Well, let's see here. Let me turn it on for people who want to call us.
And you better call, please.
I hate it when this happens. What happens is when you call us, you can call us using Skype, and we're Gabnet Live is our ID, or you can phone us, and I keep forgetting the number. I pay for it. I should remember it, right? But I don't. The number is, you ready? 347-352-0079.
0079.
Yeah, 347-352-0079. Okay? So you can call that number.
Can I roll on over?
If you want to roll on over, you can roll on over and come see me, and here she comes, and
it's
we're waiting. What?
What's that?
Don't ask me when we're off the air. Don't ask me when we're on the air. It's all the way down there. Nobody's going to see it. It's a thumb drive.
I just wanted to know what
it's a thumb drive. Okay. It's a thumb drive. Okay. So, and if you use Skype, then we will be able to see you. That's the nice part about that.
Right.
Yeah. And would you just get in the frame? I'll get back here.
Okay.
You there?
There we go.
Okay. Anyway, here is somebody. Oh, Lee Presson, son of a bitch. Hello, Lee.
Hey, Lee.
Wait a minute. Gotta wait for the picture to come on.
Hi,
and
Lee.
Let me see here. I go boom, and there's Lee Presson, ladies and gentlemen. Hello,
how you
Lee.
Doing? I'm going to get the mic in place here.
All That's right. a hey. Great looking mic. I love the way it rolls
thank you.
Over.
It's a great microphone.
Look
you know,
at that.
Lee, at one point, for a very short time, because it was towards the end of my time in San Francisco, was the house band for the Alex Bennett Breakfast with Bennett's.
Wow.
As much as he was allowed to have one. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you only did one, right?
We did about, I think we did three.
Did you do three?
Look, everyone's calling in.
Oh. Lost you. Oh, dear.
Don't worry. Don't worry.
Oh, there you are. Okay.
Yeah. You'll, I want, oh, there we
there
go.
You
there
are.
You're in. And now Phil, I, wait,
and there's
Scott Boddicker. I don't have a picture on Phil. But anyway, Lee was there the day that was my last day at Live 105 in San Francisco.
Yes.
And he didn't know the drama that was about to unfold.
But you had no idea. We were just paid to play.
A historic moment. I've been negotiated my exit from the station, and they were going to continue to pay me for, what was it, 14 months, I think. And yeah,
that's
not
nice.
Bad. But, you know, the money eventually does run out. You know, yeah. It's not like that goes on forever. In fact,
I think the station lasted 14 months after you left,
yeah.
I think.
But I'll tell you something. I'll tell you what's really funny is people used to say to me, oh, that must be wonderful. They're paying you all this money. And then it was an enormous amount of money that I was getting at that time to not work for a year. And I went, no, it's actually insulting. I said that it's worth something like $300,000 for these people to make sure I don't show up, you know. So yeah. it, there's that part of it. You go around going, I am hated, you know. Who just called us on the phone? Boy, everybody's calling now.
Yeah, hi, Jason.
Hey.
Hi, Scott.
Hey, Alex. It's Christine.
Hello, Christine. How are you?
It's been a while, honey.
Yeah, I know. I know.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you why. And I finally get to talk to Marjorie. Lady, you're a goddamn saint.
She's a saint? Why is she a saint?
For marrying him.
She's married the Hubba Hubba Burning Love.
Oh, Hubba, oh, really? Hubba, hubba. Is that what I am?
Oh, yes. I didn't
say always, you were always that.
The Hunka Hunka Burning Love? Or Hubba Hubba Burning Love, you said?
Hunka Hunka.
Hunka Hunka.
Hunka Hunka.
By the way, we've been joined by Jason. We've been joined by Jeff Stein. So,
Phil.
Yeah, we're about three away from a full house. How about that already?
And that's awesome.
Yeah.
And I'm drinking wine because I need it.
Oh, really?
I can identify with that.
Yeah. Did you hang out?
Well, since I've talked to you, Alex, I became a mom.
You really?
At 50.
Oh, okay. It's not mine.
Really?
It's not mine or anything like that. Right?
Oh, God, no.
Oh, okay.
No. I took a guardianship of my 12-year-old niece, who's now 13 and full of hormones.
Oh, really?
Congratulations.
Oh, so you didn't give birth, but you became, you are a mom, nonetheless.
Yeah, to a teenager in eighth grade with hormones. And I keep on calling my dad every week going, I am so sorry for everything I ever did.
Yeah. Well, you never had any kids either. So we're two people who found each other later in life, and neither of us ever had any kids.
And we're still selfish.
And we both could have.
Yeah.
That's the other part about it. I mean, Jeff, you have what? Two? You had two kids?
I had two kids and then a third.
That's your way of telling me, no, I had three kids.
I know. But I got married twice, so.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So that's how.
No,
I've got four granddaughters.
Wow.
And some of them are teenagers.
Oh.
So I know exactly what's going on.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I took her in August, and it's been a challenge. And today I finally got, thank God the government came through for me, and I got assistance because I've been doing this on under a $70,000 salary in San Francisco. You do the math.
Yeah, well, Sam, $70,000, it used to be, if you made $70,000, I'd say, well, boy, lady, you're making the big bucks now. But today in San Francisco, $70,000 will get you a hovel somewhere, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And I had to go, and I don't qualify for food stamps for her. But I did qualify today for, they call it non-needy dependent care, which I'd never heard of.
Now, Phil is probably bothered a great deal by this because you're living off the dole. Right?
You know, Christine is a conservative, and she's doing what she has to do to get by.
How do you know
right.
she's
and
living
I, and I mean,
conservative?
Here, here's how it went down.
Are you a conservative, Christine?
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit.
Oh, my God.
Uh-oh.
Wait a minute, you and Marjorie are connected to me on Facebook, and I don't make a lot of political statements.
I do.
I keep it just, I know you do. I see it, but I still adore you. And it's like, you know what? I agree to disagree. I am, you know, I don't know, I'm kind of iffy about the president.
He's not my president.
I know.
He doesn't want to be.
He doesn't want to be. Okay, Christine.
But I have to be respectful of the position, and that's what I'm trying to do. I may not agree with everything, but I have to do that to be true to myself.
I go on his Twitter account and tell him to fuck himself almost daily.
I do.
I swear to God. And the person's taken off immediately.
The Secret Service.
Oh my God, Marjorie, you're
a
hysterical.
Be a knock at my door one day, but I do it at least once, sometimes two, three times a day.
Yeah. So anyway, so let me talk to the other people, Christine.
I'm
here
for a
moment.
Go ahead. Yeah. No, it's
good
all
night.
About me. Didn't you know that shit?
Yeah. But you'll find something to join in on here, I'm sure.
Good night, everyone.
Yeah. Good night.
Good night. Good night. A pleasure to meet you, Mrs. Bennett.
Yeah. Anyway, so.
No, it's actually Schwartzman.
Yeah.
So, oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I knew him during his swinging bachelor pad days, so in San Francisco, so he's Alex Bennett to me.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, boy.
Well, Alex hit on me in those days.
Oh, jeez.
Ray!
Listen.
Me too.
Yeah. Who was that basketball player who said he slept with 20,000 women?
Will Chamberlain.
I won't say that I was having a lot of sex in those days, but one day I was in an orgy and I looked at the guy next to me and it was Will Chamberlain. No, just a joke. Anyway. So how is everybody? Phil, where were you last night?
I decided to go do a social thing. The club I belong to for underwater photography had a meetup at this place in the city. It was just south of where the AT&T Park is. Mm-hmm. I forget the name of the joint. It was very nice. I had a fun time, a dozen oysters, and it was good.
Yeah, I used to do underwater photography.
Oh, yeah.
Until I found out you actually had to have a camera that operated underwater, and that was what I was doing wrong.
Now, underwater was what your real estate was back in the day.
Yeah, well, you can go out now and just photograph, coral reefs that have been bleached.
Yeah. It gives you good white balance.
Just take a picture of your ass, Phil. I'm sure that's pretty good white balance.
Well, at least I wipe mine, Jason. You got half brown ass, so... and it's not because you're Mexican.
Is that part of your next plan to Australia or something? To do a little photography underwater?
Yeah. I've been doing it for years. But if I get to Maui, I want to do a book called The Hot Nights of Maui. And so I'm going to dive them, photograph them, map them.
And then since there's no publishing left in this country, you won't get it published.
Well, I'll self-publish. I want the pages to be waterproof. So that you can flip them.
Really?
You can even write on them with a crayon or something. And that they won't get messed up down at the dive site.
Gee, Renee just called, and I don't see her.
No, she's here today. Gone to Maui, I guess.
Something. She'll try again here any second.
When I was in Cozumel and I was only doing the snorkeling, but there are people scuba diving below me, mm-hmm. and it was just I wish I had a camera. When I was swimming through their bubbles, because it was really cool, watching all the bubbles come up at you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, what that does is it attracts all the sharks, so it hits the guys up on the surface.
Oh, the sharks were coming around, but they're like, ooh, that guy's too spicy. I can't eat him.
He's a local.
Yeah. You can hope you meet up with a shark who has IBS.
Hey, I got friends that just got back from the Bahamas doing a tiger shark dive, and they get pictures and so forth. It'll probably be in Outdoor Magazine and a few others. They were hand feeding tiger sharks right out there with them, petting them. There's one called Emma, which everybody knows, and Emma kind of just sullies up. She'll bump your camera.
Mm-hmm.
My friend Jason on a previous shark dive Emma took his camera and then spit it out a few feet away. You know, she gently took it.
Jason, yes, how's sir. Life been going for you? Because we only get to hear from Jason once about every 2 weeks because his wife will only let him call once every 2 weeks, right?
Yeah.
And is she in the house at all tonight?
No, actually, she went out with her sisters to some charity event, so it was nice to see her get out and go do something.
Yeah.
And it's my night to call anyway.
And this is your night to call. Yeah. I mean, if she, let's say next Friday she goes out with a friend. Could you then call? Are you then allowed to call? Or is there? Are
oh,
you,
yeah.
Oh, so you yeah, don't.
Well, what did they say? Well, the cat's away, the mice will play.
Mice will play. Exactly. Exactly.
You know, in my younger days, that would have been me going out to the bar, and Gab Night is me going out to the bar.
Do you remember when you were younger and weren't pussy whipped?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's really got you by the short hairs, doesn't she?
Yeah. Hey, you know, happy wife, happy life.
Yes.
Certain things you don't want to push too much.
Right, right. So, anyway.
Yesterday, I just looked it up where I went. It was the Mission Rock Resort. You remember, have you ever been there?
No.
No? Down off of like 3rd Street?
Mission?
Yeah, the Mission Rock Resort. It's been there a million years.
Is it like a hotel with a pool in it and stuff?
No, it's a restaurant.
Oh,
and
no,
a bar.
I've never been there.
It's pretty cool. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, so you got social. That's nice.
Alex?
Yes?
You would not believe that whole area now, like, you know, where the ballpark is.
Yeah.
You never went there at night, right?
Well, I used to work near the ballpark for a short time when I was working for Clear Channel, and they had all their stations.
Peanuts, hot dogs.
One building right down near the stadium.
There's apartments now and everything. It's insane. And it's like
it's very nice.
Walk around and not feel like you're in danger, whereas before when I was in my teens or 20s, clubbing, you know, I'm like, what the hell was I thinking?
Well, this place was only a few blocks from the San Francisco Hells Angels headquarters. And so the area was super seedy for many, many, many years. And now it's built up. It's really gentrified. You've got the new Warrior Stadium is being built is being built very close to where I was. And you got the Benioff San Francisco General Hospital right there. It's much nicer than it ever was.
Well, you say nice, but gentrification isn't necessarily nice.
This was.
Yeah. You know, I mean, sometimes I always liked the seedy part of town, you know. Yeah. I always liked it because it had a certain flavor to it, you know.
Come on to Detroit, man. I can show you a lot of seedy areas.
There it's dire, but you know what I'm saying. I mean, here.
But you're a dude.
Here in New York, they cleaned up Times Square.
Oh, yeah, I was good.
You remember how kind of interesting Times Square was back in the day?
A lot more.
You watch Taxi Driver. If you don't remember?
Yeah, exactly. Taxi Driver is a perfect example. Jeff, tell him. Tell him what.
Yeah, 42nd Street was. I mean, it depends upon what age. If you were 12 years old or 25 years old, there was a lot of stuff that you never saw before.
I saw there was a place that used to be called Hubert's Museum. Do you remember that?
Yes.
Yes, and it was a place of they sold stuff in there. But I think they also had stuff in there. I can't remember what the actual thing was all about. But anyway, Hubert's Museum had a window, and they would display things they were selling inside. And they had the display in the front, when I looked one time, was, you ready for this, dildos and knives.
Together.
I mean, two things. What two things don't go together? Well, maybe if you're into rape, you know, dildos and a knife is a good idea. But otherwise, it just. And I went only in New York City, in Times Square, at Hubert's Museum, would you see a window with a display of dildos and knives?
Well, you can probably see it on 10th Street also.
Huh? Yeah.
It's also 8th Street in San Francisco. That's also where you'll find it.
Oh, really? Oh, Hate Street has become that now?
Well, it's been that for a while.
Hate's awful.
Weird art. It's got a lot of that 60s Summer of Love flavor
no.
in Hate Street.
It's been prepackaged. The entire Bay Area is turning into the world's largest outdoor Olive Garden. Scary.
Yeah, I didn't notice any Olive Gardens on 8th Street, but it's a good photography spot to go. And, you know, there's some interesting things. Thai restaurant with an odd name. I forgot what it was called. But
McDonald's.
Yeah. Well, there's a McDonald's. And, you know, if you want to have the smell of urine, that's where you go.
Look who is here, ladies and gentlemen. Patrick.
Hey.
Hello, Patrick.
Patrick's back.
Now, Patrick
didn't want his kidney.
Huh? No, they didn't. He didn't have his operation or his whatever they were going to do with your.
Surgery. It's considered surgery.
Yeah, it's considered surgery. They were going after some kidney stones, and because you are a paraplegic, you can't feel them to begin with, and secondly, they won't pass through you, right? Because
I use the catheter.
Well, when you use the catheter, can't they come out through the catheter?
No, because inside the part that goes into the bladder only had two small holes.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So it drains urine, but it won't drain a stone.
So since you can't pee, per se, then the stones can't pass. So they have to go in and get them. So every now and then you got to go to the hospital, take some whiffy gas, and they go in there and clear out the stones until a couple of years later when they say, you got some more, let's go in and get them again.
Yep.
You would think that just becoming a paraplegic was enough of a problem, but it causes all these other problems as well, right?
Well, not for everybody. I mean, I know some cripples that don't have the issue.
Yeah.
And you know, and they're lucky me that does, so.
Yeah. Well,
hey,
anyway.
I was wanting to ask you, Patrick, how are your rotator cuffs?
Fine.
My cousin, he got in a car accident a few years ago, and just because being in a wheelchair, he's freaking torn up his shoulders, and he had to go in for a rotator cuff surgery recently.
Oh, yeah, I haven't had really any problems.
Knock on some wood, man.
I exercise regularly.
Yeah, he does too, man. He lost a lot of weight, you know, after his became very a lot more health conscious and everything after his accident. And you know, I can't believe he, you know, probably doesn't weigh 130 pounds now. And you know, just
did he actually go on a diet, or was it because he became a paraplegic?
I think a little both, but he once he became a paraplegic, he was very conscious of what he was eating and also was exercising all the time and everything too.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
He was always very vain, but you know, once, you know, that happened to him, he became even more vain and wanted to be, you know, the picture of health.
Yeah. Well, when I get these niggling, horrible little things that happen to me, you know, health wise, I think I compare that, Patrick, to you and how with such grace you handle this whole thing, you know. And I'm sitting here because I got a torn meniscus or whatever it is, and I'm bitching about it. I can't walk, I may never walk again, you know. And I say, oh, wait a minute, if I say this to Patrick, he's just gonna laugh. You know,
that's one thing that I learned, was to be more empathetic to people than I had been prior to becoming a para.
Yeah.
I understand that not everything's great for everybody, you know, and everybody different. So it's a matter of your own pain tolerance and your individuality, you know. Yeah. I mean, I may look at it and go, well, that's bullshit, who cares? But I'm not you, so.
Yeah.
You know, and there's other people that couldn't handle what I deal with.
Absolutely. Let me just tell everybody right now that if you're listening to us on Gabnet, you can also go over to Facebook and watch us as well. We show a video of our proceedings every evening now on Facebook Live, which is on my Facebook page at facebook.com/abennett. We are also, as I say, you can hear our audio at gabnet.net. And a little bit later tonight, we will have this whole show posted on gabnet.net as well. So you can take a look at that. So anyway, Lee, so you're a San Francisco guy, right?
I am, yes. Bay Area, born and raised.
Yeah. Where do you live exactly?
Right now I am in Oakland. I was born in Marin.
You were born in Marin? Where in Marin?
Greenbrae, Marin General Hospital.
Really? I was raised in Marin.
Yeah.
But I was born in San Francisco at the Children's Hospital.
Yeah.
You know why? Because I was a child. Somebody once had a great joke about the Children's Hospital. He says, you know, I don't really believe it's Children's Hospital. I said, why? He said, there are no places to put a bike in the front of the Children's Hospital.
Yeah.
You know. No bike racks. That was it. Oh, well. I blew the joke because I couldn't remember the punchline. Anyway. So,
calling Dr. Hauser.
Yeah. Calling Dr. Hauser.
Yeah, Doogie. Doogie Howser.
Oh, Doogie Howser. Well, he's also calling Dr. Howard, calling Dr. Fine. Calling Dr. Howard, calling Dr. Fine.
There's also that.
Yes, there's that as well.
The Three Stooges were very big for about 18 months during your run at KITS.
I never got the Three Stooges. Can I say that? How many here like the Three Stooges? Would you raise your hands?
I was more of a Marx Brothers guy.
Yeah, then Jason and Patrick are my pals tonight. I could never. What was funny about the Three Stooges? Will you tell me?
Slapstick.
No, it wasn't even slapstick. It was bad slapstick.
Well, yeah, but it was easy to watch because you could get it on TV in the afternoon for nothing.
Yeah, well, that's right. But it wasn't that I didn't like comedy teams. I loved, I loved Laurel and Hardy, for instance.
Laurel and Hardy is amazing.
It's amazing.
I grew up on that.
Yeah.
I grew up on that. My dad taught me that.
And I love the Marx Brothers.
Yeah, there you go.
You know, but they were intelligent. And just the Three Stooges were just so stupid, and the comedy was so low, and there were no jokes. They just hit each other with sound effects, and, I did nothing for me.
Yeah. I guess you didn't appreciate good sound effects.
There is that, yes. They were a treasure trove of sample material.
Yeah, exactly. Well, is there anything happening in the news we should talk about?
Really?
You
have to ask that question?
Last night, Phil wasn't here, and I don't think, correct me if I'm wrong, were you here last night? You were here last night, Scott, right? Yeah?
Yes.
And Jeff was here. And both of you would have to agree that I think, except for one kind of vague reference to Trump, we didn't mention his name once in the whole hour and a half of the citizen panel. Yeah.
Okay. We were hoping that he retired.
What'd you say, Jeff?
I said we were hoping he retired.
We were hoping he'd retired. Yeah, we hope against hope that he had retired.
I think he's going to get a podcast.
Who?
Trump.
Really? Why?
Because Twitter, they're going to take it away from him. So
they're going to call it Blabnet.
They're going to take Twitter away from him?
No, that kind of. But he's doing a little better, and he's making friends with the Chinese.
Well, look who's sitting up tonight.
Yeah, how about that for a change? I get to sit up.
Rob Alfano, ladies and gentlemen, has joined us. The voice of Gabnet.
That's because his bed wasn't made.
I'm sitting outside. It's beautiful out, and I've got a big pork butt in the smoker right over.
Yeah,
I don't know if you can see the smoker over there, but there's a
nice
huge pork butt in there that's smoking.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Isn't pork the other white meat?
That's right.
There's a joke there somewhere, but I can't exactly come up with it.
You know what?
How about all meats matter? No, never mind.
You know what that matter. Pork is saying to you right now, Rob?
What's it saying?
We couldn't hear that, Phil.
Oh, you didn't hear it?
Oh, pretty rough.
It just cuts off at the end. What is that?
Oh, it's a pig screaming.
Oh.
That's Rush Limbaugh delivering a speech.
Yeah, yeah. There's Brian, ladies and gentlemen. You're not home, are you, Brian?
No, I'm not. Not at this time, no.
When are you going to be home? Soon?
Probably about, worst case scenario, half hour. Best case scenario.
Oh, okay, well, stick with us, and then when you get home, you'll hang up, and then you'll call from the house. So we can see your lovely face. But we have a full house tonight. So.
You're right.
Yeah, I might not be able to get through if I do that.
Well, I will make sure you do. Okay.
I will kick myself off for you.
Yeah, somebody
you
will
don't have to do that.
Yeah, but anyway.
No, I got a kid. I gotta feed her soon.
Oh, okay. You're making a big deal out of this having a kid thing. You know, they're not difficult to have. You can just like take them from a cart at Safeway. You know.
So, I kind of did. Are you kidding me? And then I'm going.
And only one out of ten parents will complain. So you know. But anyway,
no, I now know the purpose of wine.
Well, the reason I never had kids was I never trusted a woman to have them with. You know? Because I considered it.
No, you used a condom. You were smart.
Well, I use that a lot. Yeah. But no, but I was always I had a little thing about I didn't want to have a kid by somebody who I wouldn't be staying with for the rest of my life. I you know, because I use my parents as an example. And so I didn't just promiscuously go out and have kids because I wanted little carbon copies of me. And as a result, I waited too long. And now all that comes out is dust. So.
Well, that's kind of what I thought was my gig. And I made a promise to my mom 10 years ago when she was in the hospital dying that I would always take care of this child. I don't know if she had some insight to what my sister would do or wouldn't do. So when push came to shove last August, 2 weeks after I turned 50, and the kid called me crying saying, I don't feel safe, I went down, filled out the paperwork, and took guardianship.
Wow, that's terrific. Why didn't the kid feel safe? What were the problems? Can I ask you?
Well, you know, drugs. She'll say that she's not on drugs. She's homeless now. She doesn't work. She was in a homeless shelter with all the services.
This didn't utilize them. This is the mother.
Yes.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was like, I work in San Francisco. I work 50 hours a week. And I'm like, I'm not going to let this child suffer. And I said, look, you know, her mom took all her stuff. And so she had no clothes. I took her out of school. She had been going to school with kids since she was in preschool and put her in eighth grade in a new school. And it's been a challenge.
Yeah.
But you know what? I'm not going to let the kid. And now I'm not anti-fun pants. Now I'm really strict and not cool.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, I'm trying to take every day as it comes.
Let me ask you this, Christine. Has the kid tested you out to see how far the kid can go?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, but she's a good kid. And she said to me, I don't want to be like mom.
Well, good.
And so I'm like, okay. You know, and
so in a strange way, her mother set a good example for her.
Actually, you know what? That is perfect. Perfect to say. Because, and her father. She doesn't know her dad that well. He's been in and out of jail his entire life.
Wow.
He wants to know her now because he's had some epiphany and is now, you know, out of jail and working. And I'm like, she's 13. She doesn't want to talk to you. I'm not going to force
Who's his child. Family? The Jukes family? For crying out loud. I mean, everybody's got problems there.
You know, Alex, it's funny. I grew up in a really great family.
Yeah.
My dad was a bank president. In fact, when I was 18, I sat on your lap in your studio because you said I was legal, and my mother called in and talked to you and was like, don't touch my daughter. I'll never forget it as long as I live. This is at the Quake, actually.
Was that at the Quake? Wow.
Yes.
Now I think about it, that was a good, I don't remember it, but that was a good bit if it happened that way. You know,
oh, it was hysterical.
Kid sitting on my lap, mother calls, I take the call on the air, and the mother goes, don't touch my daughter. I think that's wonderful.
Yeah, it was. I'll never forget it as long as I live.
That's but, what you know, we call like, good radio.
Yes. And then you took us to breakfast at the Stuffed Bagel.
Right. We had this place, I had a trade out at the Stuffed Bagel, and I would take a bunch of comedians and people down, and we would have breakfast.
And we were there with Monty Hoffman.
Oh, God.
And Stephen Pearl.
Yes. There, Steve
I'll
still
never forget it.
Steve still does the show here.
Is he single?
Monty is dead, and that's not a bad thing.
I know. Well, but you know, I'll never forget his giggle.
Yeah. Did he come on to you, by the way? He must have.
No, he came on to my fat friend. It was more his style.
Oh, really? I didn't know he because he was fat himself, so I thought he wanted thin women, you know?
No, and I was like, well, I could always buy you guys flour.
You know, the biggest complaint I get from women who are tall is that the horrible thing about being tall is that short guys keep coming on to them. It's like short guys love tall women. And I don't know why, because if I were short, what, are you short, Jason? Yeah, you said you were, didn't you?
Yeah, I'm only 5'5", but hey, man, you get a nice big woman. Ooh.
Yeah, but like why do you want to do that? Because you're short to begin with, and you must have some kind of, little problem with that. But you're
and
short.
And then being short, and then you have a normal average-sized penis, it just makes it look even bigger.
Yeah, well, I always like short women because they make my penis look bigger. Okay.
Yeah, but, you want small hands.
Yeah, exactly. But the point is that I would think that if you were short, you would not want to go out with tall women because they would only make you look shorter.
No, it's a challenge. When you're fucking them, you can suck their titties.
The dirtiest Scott has gotten on this show.
That's the Catholic boy.
You better go to church tomorrow, Scott.
Scott, wait a minute. You're Catholic?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You should have heard what my wife just said to me.
Yes, Patrick, you have your hand up.
Now imagine being in a wheelchair. Now, I've been short anyway. When I walked, I was not a tall guy. But being in a wheelchair, I'm still short. I love it. Because, let me tell you, when you're in a crowd, you don't get any flack from anybody when you're looking at a fine ass. Because what else is there to look at?
Right.
However, there is some nasty ass out there, too. So you get the good with the bad. But nobody ever yells at me for staring, because, hey, what else am I supposed to look at?
Who's got some kind of radio on or something?
Somebody. I'm dead silent here.
I know, you're dead silent.
Yeah, nothing here.
Christine, you don't have a TV set on or anything, do you? Christine?
No, I was outside.
Oh.
I'm sitting outside because it's so stinking beautiful.
Oh, okay.
And there's neighbors having margaritas.
Okay. Well, the sound's gone now, so you must have been walked past something that was on or something. I don't know. But anyway, where were we? We were talking about...
So you were asking me about what kind of family I had. I actually, had a really normal family. It's just my brother and sister, hung around with some shady people, and we lost my mom that was the rock, and they fell apart.
Wow.
And now my brother and sister are codependent on each other and homeless living out of their car right now.
Yeah. Well, back a few years ago, I lost my mother, and I didn't really lose her. I just don't know where she is. So anyway,
I got to meet your mom, and she was your mom. I got to meet Ruth, and she was just adorable. You just wanted to pick her up.
No, but that was her. You know, I mean, to begin with, she was a selfish, self-centered woman. But to everybody else, she was so nice and so cute because she would like do this thing to people to like suck them in. And they go, oh, you have such a wonderful mother. She's so wonderful. You're so lucky. I said, hey, she's not your mother. She's my mother, and I've got to live with her as my mother. You know what I'm talking about, Patrick?
Well, what I was going to say is I love my mother. I don't really have any problem.
What is that? What is that?
We're on a sitcom.
Yeah, we got a laugh track now.
Here's the deal. My mother, and I'm sure there a number of you on here can relate to this, my mother had a normal voice and then a telephone voice.
Ah.
She could be screaming at me when I was a kid, and you would have sworn that Satan was in the room with me, and the fucking phone would ring, and she would go, hello? Just as nice as could be, and then she'd get back to screaming at me after the phone call was over. So, it was like, that's where I can kind of see what you're saying with your mom. She was one way with you.
Yeah.
Exactly. In one way with everybody else. So I'm getting screamed at, the fucking phone ring, she turns into an angel.
She was always sweet and nice to everybody and just adorable. And I think Christine can attest to that because she met my mother, right?
Yes.
And to me, she was my mother. She was a pain in the fucking ass.
You know what, though? I thought that about my mom. But now that I'm stepped into the role of like a parent,
mm-hmm.
I get frustrated. I mean, this morning I ripped the kid a new one on her grave.
Well, you have you have a single track mind on this subject. I mean, it all comes back to what a pain in the ass it is. So I'm glad
no,
I didn't
have
any
kids. It's
not
a pain in the ass, but it is hard. And now I finally see it, and I'm like,
let's see.
Oh my
Jason,
God,
Jason, you've got a kid, right? Is it a pain in the ass?
No, but he's only nine, so
yeah,
I'm sure he's gonna be because he's a lot like me, and I think once I
oh my God, he's a boy, what, it's totally different.
Wait till he starts stealing cars.
That's a Trump comment because why? Because he's Spanish.
I say,
Mexican?
Yes,
Mexican?
Right.
What?
All those immigrants, they steal cars. Well, you know that.
That's from Detroit.
Yeah, well, in Detroit, there are a lot of cars to steal. They come right off the assembly line.
Yeah.
But actually,
yeah, some people do. They break right into the factory parking line. You know, be like five people. They steal five cars.
They want them while they're still under warranty.
But, but my question is, if you steal them in the lot at, say, General Motors or wherever, can't they find those because they're not registered or anything else, or are there ways of getting around them?
They go out the gate, they go a few miles down the road in Detroit, and they chop them.
Really? Yeah. Wow.
Sell the parts.
Immediate recycling.
They chop them
and
they sell all the
job
parts.
They do recycling that shit than the government does.
And then the cars go to... The cars go to auction, and then they go back and they buy the frame of the car, and they put all the parts back on the car and resell it. Yeah.
Now, Jeff's had kids, obviously. He had two and then another one, as he told us earlier.
Yeah.
And Patrick hasn't had any kids. And Phil has two, am I?
Yeah.
Yeah. And Scott, no. you have two, right, Scott?
Two, three, what's it matter?
Wait,
Scott, that's hilarious.
Rob hasn't had any kids, but his wife, is she still pressuring you?
No.
No, she gave up on that?
I think
no,
so.
No, she cut his dick off.
Either way, quiet. I don't want to do it.
Well, you know, I mean, Rob, why don't you want kids? I mean, I'll tell you.
I'm
60. Huh?
Because I'm fucking 60.
Well, it didn't stop Alec Baldwin.
Yeah, but Alec Baldwin's rich.
Or Tony Randall.
Yeah, but they're rich. I want to slow my life down. I don't want to worry about having to keep earning. I want to be able to slow down my life. I don't want to be having to worry about providing for this mouth to feed for, you know what? I'll be when he's 18, I'll be 78. And that's if I had him today.
Do you realize have you had the problem that I've had over the years, where if you don't have a kid, you're somewhat ostracized by the people at work. Like you don't fit in exactly because you don't have any kids.
You know,
no.
I have a tendency to walk away from that because, quite frankly, I don't want to look at 100 pictures of kids. And I had a friend of mine who was the same way. He got to be near 40, and we were sitting in his office one day, and he says to me, God almighty, if somebody else walks up to me with a picture of their kids or pictures of their kids to look at, I'm just going to, you know, I'm going to just run screaming. And now he had kids, and what does he do?
Exactly.
He shows the pictures of the kids. It must be something that happens.
Well,
I don't know.
It does happen. I show pictures of, well, I don't show pictures to the people I work with.
Yeah.
But a lot of the kids I work with, and when I say kids, I'm like the mother hen.
Okay, but let me ask you this,
God.
Christine. You didn't have kids. This is a kid that you got that was fully grown. You know, it was grown. It did not come out of your body. Were you incapable of having kids, or did you just not get around to having them?
Well, I always wanted kids. I was with someone for 10 years. Mm-hmm. I called that off. And then I did end up getting pregnant, It wasn't you, sorry. And unfortunately, I miscarried. And I'm like, okay. And then I found out I had some issues going on. Got that fixed at 40, and
then the time, the clock
never happened.
The clock's ticking away at that point.
The end. Yeah.
You know, and it just never happened. And, you know, I'm like, okay, so I'm not meant to have kids. And I was okay with that. And then all of a sudden, look what happened last summer. And I'm getting a kid in the teen years, and that's hard.
Well, it's like, but we like people to go to the pound and pick up animals who are fully grown because they need to be adopted too. I don't know if that's a nice simile for me to make here, but okay, first of all.
No, I get it.
First of all, and Patrick has his hand up. Patrick, and then Jeff.
Well, remember, I had three kids, my exes.
Yeah.
So,
what the hell is
that? That's not me.
Was that you,
Lee? That's not me. No,
it ain't me.
What was it, you? Where was that sound coming from?
Well, Phil's not here. Maybe it was from him.
It could be. Could be a sound effects machine is deciding to live on its own.
Do on its own, yeah.
Yeah. So, but anyway, you had three kids that were not your own, but you were raising them, right?
Well, right. And the thing is, that was one of the, I mean, that still fucked with my head.
I know you always were saying that
yeah,
you know.
So I mean, I can relate with Christine where, you know, there was a point at which I thought, well, okay, I'm not going to have kids. And then I had them for about 5 years. And then I haven't been able to see them for 5 years.
Wow. Do you miss them?
Because of me, but she won't allow me to see them. So so until they turn adult, I don't think there's any way that I'll be able to see them. So that's one of the cruelest things that ever happened to me, was to be able to be part of kids' lives that close and that intermingled and then have that taken away. I've told people I would rather get paralyzed again than go through that in a relationship. So,
okay, Jeff, you had your hand up.
Yeah, well, there's this book that my wife read, and it was where the kid said, "Would you please get away from me, Mom, and leave me alone? But please take my friends and myself to the mall first." That's kind of what parents and kids are.
Yeah.
Often they're pain in the neck.
Yeah.
For a while, but you love them, and eventually they grow up.
Well, I just decided not to have kids because, as I say, I it was a question of, I always made sure that either I was wearing a condom or they were on the pill, and I would always ask the question before we had sex, because when I was younger, I did have a kid. I had a girlfriend that when I was 18, who got pregnant and had the child and gave it up for adoption. I tried to adopt it, but they wouldn't let me. But after that time, I was always very protective about getting anybody pregnant, because my great fear was that somebody would get pregnant and they have control of the kid, but I don't. So I was just waiting for the right person to come along and to have a kid by them. And by the time I finally decided that it was all a product of my fear that was created during that incident, it was a little too late for me to have kids. So, you know, yes, Jeff.
Well, I know two women who have children that they purchased, is what I call it, adopted kids. Mm-hmm. And one lady adopted a kid from Russia.
Yeah.
And the other lady got a kid from Central America. I'm not sure exactly which state it was. But anyway, and those things are pretty tough from a lot of people who do it. But some of the people, it works out very, very well.
So. This is an interesting question. Now, let's say, let's take one person here. Jason. Do you have both your parents still alive?
No, actually, my biological father died when my mom was pregnant with me.
Mm-hmm. And how about your mother? Is she still alive?
Yeah.
Well, let's say she goes. I'm not hoping she does. This is just part of the exercise we're doing here. And let's say you become an orphan. Could Marjorie and I adopt you?
Yes.
Could I go through adoption of a how old are you now, Jason?
I am 36.
Okay, it's 36 years old. Can I adopt a 36-year-old orphan?
Yes, you could.
Not legally.
Yes, could
yes,
I?
You can.
Huh. I'm an independent adult. I can't be adopted by somebody. Adoption
yes,
is taking
you
over responsibility.
Could.
I'm so sure that's correct.
Adoption is taking over responsibility, saying I'm responsible for this person and I'm their parent. I don't know. You
no,
know,
but
a
you
good
could
person
also take their name.
That's just taking their name. That's not because adoption is guardianship. You can't take guardianship over
an adult who is necessarily mentally... guardianship. I mean, I wonder about that because it's more than guardianship. What she's doing is guardianship. If you adopt, the kid is probably taking your name, and it becomes a part of the family, an integral part of the family, and the next best thing to blood, really, I guess. So I just wonder if you can adopt somebody that old.
If Marjorie can adopt me any day she wants.
Yeah, well.
I'll wait for that.
That's my wife you're talking about. Take my
Alex,
wife, please.
We all love Marjorie. I don't think you realize that.
Yeah, well, you know, it's like me and my mother. Anyway.
Oh, my God.
Jekyll
and like I said earlier, she's a goddamn saint.
Well, she has to be some kind of saint to live with me. And I'm some kind of saint because I have to live with her. So, you know, it goes both ways.
No, she's darling. If I could handpick someone for you, I couldn't. You couldn't have done better.
Well, I did. I did pretty good. At an older age, the fact that I found somebody to settle down with was a blessing, you know, of sorts.
She's number four, right?
Yes, she's number four.
See, I know your wife.
Yeah, well, of course, but that's not difficult. You say number one, number two, number three, number four. God, I've been married four times. That's terrible.
And if I remember correctly, one of your exes is Ronnie.
Yes. Yes, I still speak to Ronnie, and I still speak to Susan. And the first one, I don't know where she wound up. I don't even know if she's still alive. Scott, you had your hand up.
According to LegalZoom,
yes,
you can't adopt an adult.
You can't.
You can.
Oh, you can.
Yes. You can't.
See, told you. Just go with me.
You can adopt me,
Alex. One of the examples
is
if you were adopted by somebody else and you wanted to get readopted by your legal mother or father, you can do it that way.
Yeah.
Is one of the examples they said. So it is legal.
So maybe I should adopt Jason so I have somebody to put a tombstone on my grave so I won't be as bad as I am with my mother where it's still...
As long I'll put a tombstone on your mother's grave,
yeah,
too, if you want. As long as you leave me your fortunes.
Leave you my fortune? Oh, okay.
Alex, is your mother buried in California?
Yeah, she's buried next to my father.
She is.
Yeah. So anytime you want to see her, just go to the cemetery and look to the empty space next to Alexander Schwarzman.
Alex, yeah. You assume that you'll be buried. I don't think
he's going to be locked in the storage unit.
It's who goes first here because she wants to cremate me, and I don't want to be cremated. But
why?
Can't you put it in a will and then they have to? She has to respect.
But then the question is, where do I get buried? My parents, you know, never figured that I was going to have to be buried next to them.
You're a veteran, so you get a
free
grave.
Yeah. Yep.
Oh, good.
Or doesn't he get $700? Is that or
they give you some money? Yeah, but
well, here's the situation.
$700 doesn't get you burnt.
Alex, here's the thing.
Well, wait a minute. There's no space.
I'll be yours and Marjorie's child. You die, I get the $700. There you go. And you got a grandchild in the deal.
Well, as much as I like you, Christine, since you never slept with me,
I wouldn't. I wouldn't do that.
I think I'll probably give it to Jason.
Old.
What?
I thought you were the same age as my mom. And
let me ask you, because I don't, I'm not great at remembering this kind of stuff. Did I hit on you?
Oh, yeah. Oh,
okay. All right. And I assume you rejected me.
Well, I was with my fiance at the time.
Oh, okay.
When you sat on Uncle Alex's lap, did you feel anything?
I can't remember. I was only 18. I drove my dad's Impala to the city to your damn show for the very first time.
Oh, I see. Okay. So, but I did hit on you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and what did you...
And I was a regular caller, and you would just be, like, getting Mr. Hart on there whenever I'd call.
Well, you assume that.
No, you basically said that on the air once.
That I gave you a heart... I got a heart on when you called?
Yeah, because you would love my voice.
Oh, your voice was... You know, your voice is kind of... You have a fuck me voice.
Yeah.
You know.
Thank you. However, that's not happening these days.
Well, you know, it's all part of getting old.
Can you put an ad out on your GabNet page?
Like what? Christine needs to get laid? Is that what?
Sure, we'll go with that.
Yeah, okay. Because everybody else...
Hey, Patrick, are you free these days?
Would he hill it?
Would he hill... Oh, you live on a hill?
I'm going to roll and start at you.
Out of the question for Patrick.
Well, not unless you can get it up.
Huh?
Not unless you can get it up.
What, the wheelchair?
Yeah.
Okay, I think I'm blushing here.
Oh, really? Gee, how many years later and I finally made you blush? I see.
No, it hasn't been years, for God's sake.
But let me ask you this, because I always, you know, I was mentioning this last night that guys are a lot nicer than women give them credit for. I may have come on to you, but if once I got the feeling you weren't going to take me up on it, I didn't pursue, right? I was
no,
very much.
No, because you were in love with some other chick.
Yeah.
And that broke your heart. And we all lived through your breakup. And you were actually really depressed. I was worried about you at one point.
Well, that was what did I had a name for her on the air.
X.
Well, I call her X.
Yeah, but no, you did, and I can't remember the name, and I know she was younger than me, and I wasn't that old.
She was 18. Well, word, she was younger
Twitter hated got a lot of play.
The great Frank Sinatra line, Mia Farrow once said to him, supposedly a true story. She says it, in fact. She said, I said to him once when we first started going out, you know, I've never gone out with anybody over 24 years old. And he looked at me and said, neither have I.
No, she was young. Yeah, she was in her early 20s.
Oh, yeah. I know which one that was. That was the,
yeah,
the one that, you know. Not only broke my heart, but once she broke it, she stomped on it. What?
Yeah, that was hard on you. And I remember listening to you on the air going, oh, my God, he's really hurt.
Yeah, I have always bared my soul on the radio. You know, was, mm-hmm. Yeah, but Jason has his hand up. Jason?
So that's I've been listening to Life in the Passing Lane, and then I stopped for a while, and now I'm starting listening to him again. And I think you just got done with one of the episodes where you broke up for the final time.
Yes.
How old do you think you were and she was when you finally called it quits?
Okay. Now, we called it quits, and then 10 years later, we got back together again.
Oh, that okay. Right? That didn't happen.
You haven't gotten to that part yet. So that time, we broke up in 1993, maybe?
93, 94, I was
going to
say.
Yeah. And that was, 93. And then, of course, back in 2004, I met up with her again, and we started going out again, and she broke my heart again.
Right, but how old were you? Like,
I was, well, in 92, I would have had to have been, oh, God, now I got to figure this out.
You were in
out.
Your 40s, Alex.
40, maybe 43? Does that make sense, folks? Or was it, no, yeah, it would be 43. Is that, have I got my math right, Lee?
Yeah, sounds about right.
Yeah, so I was about 43, and she
was she
was about 25, maybe at that point, 26.
Wow.
Well, maybe a little older. I started going out with her. I started going out with her when she was 18, so she would have to be about 29 when we broke up.
Ryan.
No, wait a minute. Then I would have to be 53 because I think she was about 25 years younger than I was. Yeah.
I didn't think she was that much younger.
Oh, no. This is a woman that when we watch a National Geographic special, she would look at the screen and go, look, kitties. You know, so. Yeah. But anyway, I don't want to talk about that. That was a...
No, that was... But I remember you. And not long after that, I called off my engagement 2 months before, and I'd been with the guy for 9 years.
Well, yeah, so join the club, you know.
So your ex is probably like around my age, right?
My ex, yeah. Right now is about your age?
That's what I was guessing.
No, she's...
How old are you?
I think she's 50 or 51, something like that. Yeah.
Still within my age
range. How old am I, Christine?
Oh, I know how old you are. I'm 36. 74?
Huh?
You're 72, 73?
He wishes.
Oh, shut up, Scott.
He was.
Let her live with this dream.
No, wait a minute. Were you born in 41? Because I think you were the same age as my mom.
I was born in 39.
You're older than your mom.
Holy shitballs. Okay. Oh, okay.
Holy shitballs? Is that what I get? How about a little there, old man?
No. I thought, Alex, you were younger.
I thought I was, too. Thank you very much.
No, I adored you. I used to cut college classes. Oh, God, I can't say that loud so she doesn't hear it. And come see you. And I thought you were a lot younger.
Well, you know, I was. And now I'm not. This is many years later, dear.
That whole linear nature of time thing.
She doesn't seem to grasp the age thing.
You know what? I've seen you on Gabnet and live Facebook, and you look fucking amazing.
Really?
You do. A bit grayer, you do, but guys. I haven't changed a bit.
No. Sweetie, you really do.
I don't know. I look at myself, and all I see is this guy with big bags under his eyes. What?
I mean that sincerely.
Yeah.
You know, you look great.
Well, thank you very much, Christine. That's very nice of you to say. You know, I've also...
You're still the hunk of burden left.
Then I've lost like about 60 pounds.
I thought he got...
I know. I couldn't believe that. I was like, holy crap, he's getting this bead the size of my right ankle, the motherfucker.
Oh, jeez. Then you must be fat. Anyway.
No, I'm really not. You asshole.
See, look at me. Look how thin I am. Look how thin I am. Let me get back here.
No, but I have noticed you lost a lot of weight. You're looking good.
So, Christine, you don't know how to work Skype?
No, and I don't do it because I have an Italian double chin, and it pisses me off. I may be a 12, maybe a 10, and I got big boobs, but no, I don't do the chin. And
that's when you just aim the camera a little down at your big boobs.
Oh, down? Yeah, down for the boobs, up for the chin.
Yeah.
I know. I don't do selfies.
Well,
no,
that's
I
the best part, because if you got big boobs, guys are going to be looking at those. They're not going to be looking at the double chin.
Well, that would be me in the wheelchair.
Mm-hmm. Okay, she just heard me say about the boobs. Now I'm going to be explaining that tonight. Thanks, guys.
By the way, how old is she?
She's 13.
Oh, that's living hell.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
You're too old. She's too young.
Alex,
she's graduating from eighth grade.
Yeah. Okay.
And I have to go through all this investigation and stuff.
Yeah. Anyway, Phil, what were you going to say, Phil?
I thought that was your age group.
What?
Your preferred age group. 13.
No,
you've got to get this girl on your lap, Alex.
14.
I always said they had to. The only women that I will go out with have to be able to name all four Beatles. Have you ever done that, late women? Hold on a second, Christine.
Bailey.
Hold on a second, Christine. What? What, Phil?
Bailey.
Well, Lee?
Beetlejuice?
Yeah.
Lee, you got to find that that's the truth. If you ask a woman or anybody, name all four Beatles, if they can name all four of them, then they...
Exactly, yeah.
You know.
Name all five Marx Brothers. Do you object to Dr. Strangelove as a first date? These are the questions I ask.
Yeah, and name all five Marx Brothers. That's a good one. And you can name them, right?
I can.
Can you,
both
Phil?
Stage
can you
and
Phil?
Real names.
Oh, Groucho, Harpo... that's three.
Zeppo.
Gummo.
Gummo, is there
now
Gummo?
You see, Jeff knows Gummo.
Oh, wow.
Gummo never made it to the movies. Gummo became an agent.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
True.
And
he Zeppo eventually.
Yeah, I think, and he managed the Marx Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
But there was Gummo in the stage act. There
and you
five
got a problem
them.
With nepotism in Trump's administration?
Well, I mean, you know, these were the Marx Brothers, you know.
I'll tell you this. There was Julius as Groucho, mm-hmm. Leonard as Chico, Arthur mm-hmm. as Harpo, Milton was
wow.
Zeppo. No, Milton was Gummo. And then Milton dropped out before they went into movies, so they roped in baby brother Herbert, and he became Zeppo.
Right. Son of a bitch. And then he became an agent.
Yeah.
And so there was only four names.
And then he married a woman named Barbara, Mark.
No, there were four. There were five names.
No, but then...
That's the real names.
Zeppo married Barbara because she became Barbara Marx. And then I think they either got divorced or Zeppo died. I think they got divorced. And Barbara married Frank Sinatra.
Huh.
Oh, really? That's the same Barbara.
Yeah.
No, I did not know that. I'm tucking that in my little trivia pocket.
Yeah, I'm doing a web series on old movies, and I just finished a Marx Brothers film.
I believe, I may be wrong, but I believe Mary Livingston, Jack Benny's wife, was her last name, her real name was Sadie Marx, I think. And she was with the Marx family, not one of the, mm-hmm. not the sister or whatever, but. Mm-hmm. I think
I never knew that about Barbara Sinatra, though, that she was married to one of the Marx Brothers.
Yeah, she was married to Zeppo. Yeah.
Zeppo's
wow.
wife.
Wow. Yeah. What'd you say, Phil?
Zeppo's wife, and not Zeppo.
No, didn't marry Zeppo. And I can't remember whether Zeppo died and then he married her, or she left Zeppo and, you know. But he became a very successful agent in Hollywood. So, mm-hmm. you know.
You look beautiful.
Yeah. So anyway, but anyway, name all four Beatles, and they, you know, if he asks them to name five Beatles, they're really out to lunch. Can you name a fifth Beatle? Besides, not Murray the K.
No,
Billy Preston. Yeah, I got one.
Billy Preston.
No,
right?
There was
no. It was a guy.
He was the drummer, the first drummer.
Well, there was Pete Best.
Pete Best.
But there was another Beatle.
Oh,
Stu Sutcliffe.
Stu Sutcliffe.
Right.
Oh, yeah, him.
I heard that they used to call, what's his name, Billy Preston, a fifth Beatle or maybe a sixth Beatle because he played on, like, he did the keyboards on
Let It Be.
In My Life, I think. And,
yeah.
Oh, well, I thought it was the one that was a manager that they called the fifth Beatle.
Mm-hmm. You're right, Phil.
The producer, George Martin, did as much for their sound as anyone, so he was one of the fifth Beatles.
You're thinking of what's his name?
The one that sued over that the ownership of a song or something? Or was it George Harrison he sued? Or
Maybe you're thinking of, what's his name, Klein.
That could
Alan
be
Alan Klein.
Pete Best. Pete Best was the fifth Beatle.
This guy wasn't a musician. But he was known as the fifth Beatle.
He was the manager.
Yeah, he was the manager.
Well,
he was
in
a Hard Day's Night. I can't think of his name. He died. He was gay.
Yeah. I mean, what's his name? I hate myself. I can't remember.
Was the fifth Beatle?
Epstein. Brian Epstein.
Brian Epstein.
That's it. Brian Epstein. A Jewish guy. Yeah, okay.
Gay, Jewish, and an agent.
Yeah, and everything.
Who can figure?
Go figure.
Everybody in Hollywood?
Everybody in Hollywood. There were a lot of, I think it was Murray the K, though, that was called officially the fifth Beatle.
He called himself the fifth Beatle.
Did he call himself the fifth Beatle?
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. I was the fifth Ramon. No, I really was. I mean, they loved me. I would come in the morning to do my show, and there would be Joey sleeping on the couch at the radio station for waiting for me to come in.
Oh, God, I remember Joey.
Yeah, Joey was so wonderful. I love Joey.
I remember sitting there, and he was, like, tripping on something one day.
He was always tripping on something, but he was just the sweetest guy in the whole world, you know?
No, he was very nice.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway,
no,
let's...
thanks to you, I met a lot of people.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well,
what do I owe you?
So far tonight, we haven't talked about politics at all either.
Thank God.
Okay.
But let me bring something up.
There's a bunch of things to bring up.
Do you think we're going to wind up going to war with North Korea?
No.
Well,
no.
We've got a nuclear power run by a short-tempered baby man. And we've also got North Korea. So,
isn't China actually pinching North Korea on their gasoline right now?
Who?
I thought that I heard that China is pinching North Korea on their fuel.
Why are they doing that?
Sanctions. Get them to stop their program.
See. Okay. Yes, Patrick.
It's coal.
It's a lot like what happened with the U.S. and Japan when we put an embargo on fuel, and they considered that an act of war. Well, China doing the same thing in North Korea. And that's the way that China can keep North Korea under their thumb. And I guess gas has gone up something like 85% in some areas of North Korea because of this oil embargo.
So, they're paying like $2.30 a gallon.
Sounds like California.
Well, hey, I got $2.90. I was happy.
Yeah, yeah. But the thing is that China has, for years, remained friendly with North Korea because number one, they share a border. And secondly, because I think they felt that if they at least had a working relationship with them, which they could have because North Korea needs some friends, you know, that they could intervene if anything really went bad. But who knows, you know. I was thinking about it today because Trump had stated that, you know, there's a good possibility we'll go to war against North Korea or something to that effect.
Major.
Yeah.
Major conflict.
He didn't say just major. It was major conflict.
It's a double major.
It's a big major.
It was his double. It was his double major.
Double major.
And
so articulate.
And I started to think about it, and I went, if we go to war against North Korea, they might do pretty well. You know, because they're so militarized.
Oh, no way.
You don't.
We would wipe them off the map in like 10 minutes.
But they would do so much. Yeah, South Korea screwed.
Yeah,
I don't think that they could even hit South Korea.
They have an advantage. They have an advantage.
Look at Palestine and Israel with their shield or whatever that's called.
Yeah, but Palestine doesn't have an atomic bomb. Palestine doesn't have ICBMs.
Still, you blow up an atomic bomb that's in the air, and all the crap to go off to make an atomic bomb go off isn't just freaking
North Korea has an atomic bomb. It's just they can't deliver it.
Yeah. Well, they could if they used Amazon. Domino.
Yeah, if they used Amazon.
Yeah.
Send your nuclear device by UPS. Don't send it by the post office though, because they'll never get it to the right address. Patrick,
I was reading an article today about the North Korean military, and what the article was, the premise of the article was that they have like 1.5 million troops and naval personnel. However, their equipment is outdated, and they are using night vision at 20 years old versus what the United States or even South Korea would have, or China for that matter, or Japan. And their weapons are not maintained. They're prone to jamming, and the rest of their equipment, it's all dated stuff. It hasn't been updated. And there was a portion of the article that had said that the North Korean government is afraid that if the North Korean military get too close to the DMZ or even crosses into South Korea, that they very well may defect because they don't know what is available in the rest of the world. Right. They only know what they know. And so if they were to cross into South Korea, they may see even like a fruit stand and say, well, fuck this.
Hey, listen, we could probably seduce a North Korean with McDonald's hamburgers.
Exactly. That's, you know, honest to God, that's what they were saying. Yeah. Know.
Hamburgers, give them a bun.
Yes, yes, Jason.
I was saying, don't forget too. North Korea, they suspect that their atom bomb is only the power of 1/10 of the power of what we dropped on Hiroshima, you know, in Japan.
Good enough.
Well, 1/10 of the power.
Well, that's not a lot, Phil. That's not a lot.
And that's the mother of all bombs we dropped would be stronger.
Yeah, the MOB. Or I like what Stephen Pearl said. There's also the mother of all bombs, the father of all bombs, and the brother-in-law of all bombs who sits on the couch and does nothing.
Yeah. Now, what's different about all of this is that China has actually signed on to the UN sanctions against Korea. And China is also limiting or not giving the coal that North Korea needed. And its coal was their number one currency in North Korea. So because China is playing ball with the U.S. and the U.N., they may be putting enough pressure on North Korea for them to back down. And if the kid doesn't want to back down, maybe he'll get assassinated.
I think that China could get them to slow down because, you know, China is the one friend they do have. And the one person they can rely on to bail them out if there's starvation in the country, a lot of things, right?
Well, the rest of the world is also
because you can feed all of, you can feed all of North Korea with Chinese takeout.
Yeah, right. But they'll be hungry 2 hours later.
Yeah,
but,
that's a problem.
You know, the problem that's happening now is the UN sanctions, and they have agreed that if China continues to support North Korea against those sanctions and embargoes, that they will start to fine the Chinese banks and China through economically. They'll put sanctions on them. And so the world is starting to put pressure on China.
Yeah. By the way, remember, we are on video tonight, as we are each and every night, and Brian is eating something, and I'm just curious as to what he's eating because he has to wash it down with soda.
Oh, yeah.
Cookies.
Saltines.
Saltines? Oh, it's very nice. I just wondered, just, you know.
With apple crackers. Butter, I
Some
hope?
Some lovely crackers.
With what?
Some lovely
with
crackers.
Apple butter or something?
Do you have your hand up, Jeff?
Yeah. No. So, Alex, you might be the one person here who would know about North Vietnam. I'm sorry, North Korea.
Vietnam.
No, North Korea and South Korea in 1952.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a war between the two of them.
Right.
And the North was doing pretty good.
And who was doing really good?
The North was pretty damn good. I mean, ultimately it changed.
Well, you have to remember that North Korea's main stock and trade, if they have a business, if they have a hobby, it's armies, you know, and weaponry, or trying to have weaponry. And that's why I'm saying they might be a hard nut to crack if we go against them. It might be a lot harder to take care of them than to take care of a lot of other countries.
You know, their people may just cut and run. You know, they live in fear, and it's only those soldiers that you see in the main cities. If you talk to the people out in the farmlands and so forth, they're starving. That whole country is starving.
I know. No, this country is in bad shape. If you look at it from a satellite at night, there are no lights on. You know, I mean, that's anywhere. Patrick. Yeah.
Remember during the Korean War, Jeff, that the weaponry that the North Koreans had, was fairly new because they were being supplied by the Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. And the Soviet Union, North Vietnam, North Korea, they all had the new AK-47. Anything mm-hmm. that was new and coming off of the assembly line, they were all very tight allies, like the United States, Britain, and France is now. Where if North Korea needed AK-47 supplied or whatever they needed for bomb equipment, mines, and that would have all come from the Soviet Union. And it's the same with North Vietnam. I mean, they were getting their shit right from the Soviet Union. So that's why they're, you know, and a lot of our guys in Vietnam, they would pick up the AK-47s and throw the M16s down because the AK-47s were so much more superior and reliant than the M16 A1.
Would jam.
Yeah. Well, yeah,
dirty. They got dirty.
The only problem with North Korea now is they still have that same old equipment. You know?
Well, that's exactly.
I saw some kind of a parade going through their mm-hmm. version of Tiananmen Square. They had these giant rockets, you know, these giant rockets on beds rolling down the street, you know, as part of the thing. And somebody said it is thought that they were completely empty inside.
Yeah, we're not sure whether or not those are actually functional. Those could be intercontinental ballistic missiles. They could be big green tubes.
They
certainly want us to think they have intercontinental ballistic missiles.
Yeah, well, we love being attacked by giant green tubes.
You know, as long as the war is a real war and not just who has a better, you know, showmanship, you know.
I'm just thinking about having somebody attack you with a big green tube. I thought about the Jolly Green Giant's wife. So anyway.
Well, those are really carpet tubes. So I get asked those all the time.
Scott, you haven't said anything. What do you think about the possibilities of us going to war against North Korea?
Like it.
Oh, by the way,
Trump
said that we're sending this $1 billion system to South Korea to shoot down the Norse missiles, but we want to get paid for it. And North Korea is saying, ooh, wait a minute. What do you mean you want to get paid for it? We're going to let you put it on our land. You know, you do it for free. So Trump says, no, you want the protection. You got to pay, which is not such a bad idea.
Wait a minute. You want the protection, you've got to pay. This sounds like
mafia.
It sounds like the mob just moved into your neighborhood.
It's moving into North Korea, South Korea.
Patrick?
Anyway, they have an election coming up next week, and the guy who's the front runner is trying to table what Trump said and not make a statement because he doesn't want to be perceived as weak. So he said, well, if I'm elected, I'll review it. Basically, Trump is keeping a campaign promise, which was Japan and all these other countries, South Korea, have plenty of money. They have vibrant economies. And if they need our military assistance, we should be, reimbursed for it, for the expense of doing it. And that's what he's saying. And I agree with him.
Well, you would. By the way, Phil, Rob, I want to ask you a question. Are you sitting outdoors?
Yes.
It just suddenly hit me because I said, gee, his inside of the house looks a lot like what most people's outsides look like.
He has really good lighting out there, too.
Yeah.
Still your house you sold?
Yes, it's my house that I sold.
Did I know you're still there?
Yeah, I'm going to close the end of May.
Yeah. And then you have to be out by the end of May, or?
Yeah, we'll be out by May 20th, where we got our two-bedroom apartment that we'll be living in for the next 4 months till the end of September.
I so want to do what you did.
And they're going to build that house really fast for you, I guess, huh?
Yeah, I just heard from them today. Hopefully in the next 3 weeks there'll be a pre-construction meeting to get started.
Now, do you get to design your home, or is it like you got plan A, plan B, plan C, plan D? Pick one.
There are different houses that you pick from with different floor plans. You choose the house, you choose the lot, and then you choose what you put in the house, right? You know, like I went for an extra bedroom. I went for a media room. I'm going to build a home theater. Uh-huh. I went for a morning room off the kitchen. I, you know, then you pick what you want to do.
Are you expecting somebody to die?
Not that kind of morning. You pick your floors. So I went all hardwood on the main level. Sorry, Phil.
Sell that too.
You choose granite. You choose everything about it. Once you pick the place, you choose all the different.
And do they keep adding price onto it depending?
Yeah,
on what
sure. Absolutely. And
instead of granite, look at either Caesar stone or Sile stone, the quartz stuff. That's the new hip stuff.
That's the new thing. Unfortunately, it's not offered by the builder.
Really?
You go to a design center and they have a bunch of stuff that you could pick from, different cabinet styles, colors, different granite tops, different colors of granite.
You can take the free base and then just
You could.
Free base.
Free basing? Does anybody say free basing?
You could free base.
The free base grade.
Yeah. No, but here's the thing. You're not able to just say, hey, I'm going to build a home, and now here's how I'd like it to be, and I'd like
to... You can, but you can't go to this kind of builder. You need to go to a custom builder.
Okay, and that's going to cost more money, right?
I'm sorry?
It's going to cost more money to do it that way.
I don't know. It really depends.
There's an economy of scale in what you're doing, because the guy's probably building 30, 40, 50 other houses.
They prefab build these houses in a controlled environment, and then they ship the walls. Mm-hmm. They ship, you know, you could see it in the streets, like it starts to show up and everything's labeled, and it's really kind of cool how they like ship these pallets.
But this isn't a prefab house though.
No, it's not a prefab house, but they, instead of building it nail by nail, stud by stud on site, they build it in a controlled environment. So
Yeah, and then
it's shipped in pieces and then erected on the site.
So actually, you can get this thing built faster that way than you could if you did it from the ground up.
You're not beholden to the weather necessarily, right?
Still kind of are. It was probably take about 6 months.
I have to ask, where is this?
This is in Northern Virginia.
Hmm. And what? It's 350.
What's that?
350 on a good day.
For the house? The house was, the base of the house was 310 with all of the options. You're up near 400.
Yeah.
Pick that fucker up and move it to California.
Yeah. Just pick it up and move it to California.
It wouldn't survive an earthquake because it's not built properly for that.
You see, well, suppose there's an earthquake in that part of your neck of the woods.
I mean, where I'm living right now, I'm in a 900 square foot condo, and it would go on the market for $560.
You want to hear something really, really sad? This apartment is 2,500 square feet. Okay, that I'm in.
That's huge.
Right below me, I've been hearing hammering like crazy, and I know what they're doing. They took an apartment just like mine. We're told today by the super, same exact footprint as our apartment.
Only
what they did is they pulled all the wood out, you know, lowered the ceilings, and, you know, took all the character that, like, we have in this apartment out. I mean, what I would do if I suddenly got this apartment, or I even bought it as like a condo or whatever, or a co-op, is I wouldn't get rid of the wood. The wood is wonderful. You know, but no.
Why do they do that?
Because I don't know why they do. Because they have no fucking taste, I guess. Or maybe it's just people want that. Maybe they don't want an old wood in an apartment.
Why would you want to lower the ceiling, though?
I know why. The people below Alex are complaining that in the middle of the night they hear talking, and they don't know where it's coming from. So they're putting insulation.
Unfortunately, the one thing I got to say about this apartment house is you never hear anybody else. You really don't. I sometimes do right next door here, but I think that originally this room was a larger room in the other part of the building. And so the wall is thinner than it is anywhere else. But for the most part, I mean, people could let a bomb off in the apartment next to us and we wouldn't hear it.
I sent you soundproofing and you threw it away.
Jason.
Hey, so you've talked about losing your gas for your dryer.
Yeah.
So was your gas for the dryer before the meter or something?
No, it was right. Believe me, we weren't cheating.
No, because if it's after the meter, there's no reason why, rhyme or reason why they would remove it.
Well, this was the plumber, and supposedly they were told, according to Con Ed, that Con Ed only has an okay for one appliance in every apartment. And that if you want a second appliance, you have to apply for that, which you will not be turned down, but you have to apply for it so they can then make sure and come in and make sure that you're not stealing the gas or whatever. So I have all the pipes and everything. They could put it all back in a half hour. The guy told me he could do it on his lunch hour. Okay? But first we have to go to Con Ed, get their approval, and then the plumber can do this. Now, he may try to charge us $1,000, in which case we're just going to go out and get another plumber to do it, you know. But
because switching from gas to electric, you know, I have electric, but putting in the electric, you got to put in, you know, $220 for a dryer.
Well, no, it would cost me about $500 to put the electricity in.
You blow fuses and you turn on the air conditioner.
My super told me he would wire it down out of this apartment or something, or do something. Well, so
that's
going to
be more
okay.
Than $500 then.
No, he said he'd do it for $500. So, you know, who knows? I don't know. All I know is we've been air drying our clothes.
And that's nuts.
It was winter time. We would put a lot of our heavier stuff, like towels and stuff, on the radiators. However, it made them very rough and tough because air drying makes them soft, but putting them on a radiator makes them really rough.
You should have been going to a laundromat the whole time and saving all your receipts, and then took it to court with you when you have to deal with your dealings with the apartment.
You may have something in court against the landlord, because you could say, look, they turned off my gas, I can't cook, I can't eat, and they're doing this, it's punitive.
Take it off of my rent.
That's
why you lost all the weight. You haven't been able to eat.
I haven't been able to eat properly. Look at me. I'm a shell of my former self.
Right.
You know, it's amazing. But anyway, so, you know, it's life.
Hey, did anybody see the comments that Trump made to Reuters? Did you guys talk about that?
No.
So Trump said he misses his old life.
Oh, yeah.
He didn't realize how hard it would be to be president. It's way more work than he expected it to be, and he misses his old life. He reiterated that.
Well, we just got word today that, you know, we're spending $100,000 a day in New York City to protect Trump Tower, However, Melania and the kid are moving down to Washington. See now how much it's going to cost us a day?
How much?
$100,000. They still have to protect Trump Tower because it's one of those kind of buildings that, well, is a target, shall we say. So this guy is costing us a fortune just in taking care of his building.
Well, that's the case. Then that's going to cost that for even when he's not president.
It could be. And, you know, he's not going to Mar-a-Lago anymore.
Why not?
The season's over. So he's going to New Jersey.
I wouldn't be caught dead there.
By the way, he hasn't been in Trump Tower since he became president.
Is that right? Has his wife been in the White House?
Yes, a little bit.
Does she ever stay the night?
And stuff?
Would she ever want to stay the night? Come on.
In the Lincoln bedroom.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't trust somebody, even at his age. You know, if he hasn't been laid, he doesn't have a dog. You know, I don't trust somebody.
Oh, they meet on the weekends. When he's not golfing.
He does that.
This is too much work. Well, then you shouldn't have applied for the job. Okay?
Too much work. That's really... I had a laugh.
Yeah.
Could not believe when I heard that.
There you hear us playing ourselves off once again with our theme music. Scott, thank you for being with us tonight. We appreciate it. Phil, good to see you again tonight.
Same here. I'll give you a report from the Rube when I'm going to see the show. Bobby, I'm not taking my camera, thank you very much. But
No, he's got a lot to worry about there. Yeah, and a clicking camera would not be good at a video shoot.
No.
Okay.
No.
Christine, thank you. Call again, will you? We love talking to you.
I will. I don't have a lot of time, but I will.
When you get a chance.
You know I love you, Alex.
Yeah, but we love you too.
Alex, why don't you give your tickets to Damien?
Patrick, thank you so much. We appreciate it, and we're glad you're in better health. Brian Ludwig, thank you for joining us tonight. Lee, I love hearing from you. You're terrific. You're fun.
We miss you here in California, Alex.
Yeah, well, please call the show again, because we love you. Jason, you tell your wife, damn it, you're not pussy-whipped, and you're going to call every Friday. Scott, Jeff Stein, think the world of you, Jeff, really do. And Rob, of course, what can I say except that's Rob Alfano.
Good night, all.
Good night, everybody. Night. Okay, that's
good
it.
Good night, my dear.
Okay, and that's our crowd for tonight. Let me just turn off the Skype so the next show can use it. And okay, there we go. Anyway, I really, it was a good show tonight. We had a nice time. And I'm hoping that all of you will join us again next week. In the meantime, stay tuned for Jack and Amy. They've got a program called Intersection. And then at 1 o'clock in the morning, Eastern Daylight Time, it's the Connections coming out of Florida. So just a lot of good programming here, a lot of fun, and it's been fun with you tonight. I'll see you on Tuesday, same time, same station in life. In the meantime, should you see her, please tell her I love her, okay?